Did you just hear my mum shouting?
I thought it was a cat.
I'm going to kill her. Mum, stop shouting. I'm recording something.
No, don't worry. That's why I had to literally come from Ireland to do this, because my mum, literally, she'll knock on the door like, have you water? And I'm like, I have water. Stop. I'm doing professional things.
Hi, I'm Gina. I'm here with Nicola Coughlan, who plays Penelope in Bridgerton. And these are her Netflix nine. Okay, firstly, Nicola, you look absolutely amazing. You look incredibly Christmassy, which is great because it does come out on the 25th of December. I don't feel like it's every day that somebody gets a call from Shonda Rhimes and you know, and is like, okay, let's come into this show. How did that come about?
I honestly still can't believe I'm involved in it, even though I'm pretty sure it's definitely happening now. I met Chris Van Dusen, who's our showrunner, and he said, Shonda, and I sat down, we saw your audition tape, and Shonda says, well, it has to be her. Which, when you think Shonda Rhimes, the most powerful woman in television, an icon, a goddess,
yes,
actually, you know, chooses you personally, it's such an honor.
I hope your confidence is sky high, because to know that Shonda Rhimes said that you were the chosen one, essentially, is absolutely wild. Like, that's amazing. You know, the comments in the trailer, people comparing it to, you know, Gossip Girl, but make it 18th century. Mm-hmm. How correct are those summaries of the show?
Do you know what? I actually have an admission. I haven't actually seen Gossip Girl because I think I was just a generation beyond. Oh, have you not? Okay, okay. No. So I don't know how qualified I am to say how like or unlike it is, but the thing is, the thirst for gossip and scandal has always existed. Mm. And those scandal sheets were a real thing that were around at that time. So, you know, there was no celebrities in terms of actors or musicians at those times. It was these rich, rich families who were, you know, they were the source of all that gossip and scandal and all of those things. But normally gossip sheets used to say Mrs. M and Mr. K were seen at Vauxhall doing this. Mm. So you'd have to piece it together. Whereas Lady Whistledown just outright, just she just says it.
Yours truly, Lady Whistledown.
And also it's Julie Andrews.
Yes.
You couldn't have someone more iconic voicing that part than her. They said to us iconic, but that is iconic.
Mm-hmm. Did you get to meet Julie Andrews?
So I desperately wanted to meet Julie Andrews, and in the world pre-COVID, they were saying, we're going to fly her over to visit set. Mm. So then every day I was like a child at Christmas being like, is it today? Is today Julie Day? She's coming. She's going to walk in. It's going to be a surprise. But it kind of, I think, you know, things have changed so much this year, and we thought, of course there'll be time. And
yeah,
we were thinking about doing press, and we were like, we'll meet her then. And then, you know, but no, we haven't met her, but
this is the kind of moment where I wish that we were on a show like Ellen or something like that, where I could be like, and here she is now. She just like comes into my room. She's like, hey.
I know, but I'm like, if I get to meet her, I'm like, I don't know what it would be like for that to be captured on camera. I feel like I would be mortifying, and I'd be like weird. I'd be like, hey, Julie, girl,
JJ,
friend, love your work. Like, I don't know. I think it needs to happen where there's no recording equipment.
yeah. Okay. I think that makes sense. So it would be remiss of me not to mention the extravagance of Bridgerton, right? So the costumes are like incredible, incredibly regal, very posh, very nice. How uncomfortable were those costumes? Because some of them look like they were not the most comfortable things to wear in the world.
Those dresses were so heavy because it was a dress that had lots of embellishment on it. And then you had, you know, sort of puffy stuff underneath. That's not the technical term, but to make it bigger. And then you got like a cape that has a train that's like 6 foot. Then you've got a wig, a crown, and a feather headdress that's another 2 foot. So you couldn't, like, you can't walk anywhere. You have to get someone to like lift the train, and you just feel like a baby because you can't do anything for yourself because you're corseted. You can't sit, you know, your sort of boobs are up in your throat a little bit, especially mine. They were right up there, but they look so phenomenal. And I think Bridgerton's a really good example of letting creatives have free reign and create this world, because everything's from scratch. Mm-hmm. So everything that's in Bridgerton is just Bridgerton world. It's really magical.
I'm glad you brought up wigs, because I wanted to unpack one of your tweets about the wig that you wore.
Oh yeah.
The tweet goes as follows. Fun fact, the wig block I used was the one used for Margot Robbie in Mary, Queen of Scots. And I found it weirdly satisfying that Margot and I have the same size head.
Yeah.
How was it? How did you find that out?
Well, it had her name on it, so that was my first clue.
Oh, okay.
And then I said, then I said to them, like, I was like, was this actually her wig block? And Mark Pilcher and his team, who were the hair and makeup artists, they had done Mary Queen of Scots too. So I was like, wow, Margot Robbie and I have the exact same size head. And she's a great actor. So I feel like that's just good. It's good. Like, and we shot in Hatfield House, where they shot The Favourite. So like, I mean, we weren't meant to do it, but I snuck upstairs and I looked at Olivia Colman's bedroom. Because, you know, I believe in trying to like suck in the aura of these talented women and even trying to like...
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll take the inspiration where I can get it, you know?
Absolutely, absolutely. That's exactly what I'm doing to you right now. I'm just absorbing all of
it. We'll absorb each other's auras.
Yeah. Other than watching Bridgerton, tell me what your ideal Christmas day would consist of. So I'm talking company, food, everything.
Oh gosh. Okay. So, I mean, when you wake up, I love a box fizz.
That's fantasy. I love that.
I mean, I love presents. I know some people are like, it's not about the presents. It's just 100%. About, I'm like, it's a bit about the presents.
It is a bit about the presents.
I like presents. Oh, it's just, I love it. And then I like, it's a lot about the dinner. So I split up the cooking. Me and my mom and my sister do stuff. I am trying this year. I want to do the roast potatoes. Okay.
Okay. Right.
They don't want to let me do it, but I am a good cook. I am a legitimately good cook. And I have also been a contestant on Bake Off.
Okay,
so
right.
We did a Derry Girl special of Bake Off last New Year's. And so I made a trifle in that and I remade it for my family. So that may become a yearly thing. I may need to make it again this year. It's also just like sitting down in front of telly and a nice Baileys and just being around the people you love. And I think, hopefully this year we'll, you know, still be able to do that.
Okay, if you could invite one famous person to your Christmas, or I will give you the option to invite yourself to a famous person's Christmas, okay? Who would you choose? They can be dead or alive.
No, I think I'd go to Liza Minnelli's house.
Oh my God, that is such a good answer.
Because I feel like Liza Minnelli Christmas must just be incredible.
Yes.
You know?
Yes. Yes.
And I feel like you could get, you know, you could give her a few sherries and get her to sing and do cabaret and like, yeah. And I feel like the presents would be great. And yeah, I think that would be perfect.
Okay. So you're Irish, but you spend a lot of time in England, etc. Mm-hmm. You've played English characters. So I would like to know, despite spending so much time in England, what is the most Irish thing about you? What would you say is like categorically, you can't deny that you're Irish?
So we call it the need to feed. So yeah. I literally cannot stop. If someone comes into my house, if they do not consume a beverage or eat some food, I will feel really stressed out. And I'm like, you'll have something, you will. Go on, you have a little cup of tea or a glass. Just so, come on, a washer. You have to hydrate yourself, or you have to, like, I had, you know, people coming all COVID safe to do hair and makeup today, but I bought, I can count them from here, five, 6 packs of biscuits, a full thing of crisps, a huge thing of Diet Coke, coffee, tea. I just have to do it. I cannot stop myself.
This is a mean question, I guess, but what's the worst or weirdest gift you've ever been given?
Oh God. And it immediately came to mind, which is terrible. Oh, but I remember years ago, a boy gave me this carved wooden face.
I had no idea where that sentence was going.
Like, yeah. And I just really, you know, I think I was pretty like 17 and I was like, what am I going to do with this? Well, that's like, what?
The complete opposite then. What's your favorite gift that you've ever given?
Oh, I surprised my sister with a trip to New York for her birthday.
Now's the time I asked to be adopted.
Yes, of course. come to me. And I brought her to see Hamilton on Broadway. And we're both obsessed with Hamilton. I mean, that was a present for me as well, you know, getting to go there and do that. And we got to stand on the stage. And that was so special.
You know what? Here's something to ask you. Obviously, you're a phenomenal actor. All headlines about you are like, Nicola, rising star, amazing. Derry Girls is amazing. Bridgerton, amazing. She's best friends with Shonda Rhimes. She loves Viola Davis. Also her best friend. Best friends with Judy Andrews. But if you could do anything else, if you weren't an actor, right?
Yeah.
Anything else you could do on this planet, what would you do?
Do you know what? This is really funny because on set, I am obsessed by the art department on any job I ever do, but the art department have like their own clique and I can never quite break in. I'm always like, what did you make that thing out of? And they're like, cause they're trying to do their jobs and I'm just like fluttering around, like annoying them. But like, especially on a period drama, everything's amazing. Even like handwritten letters and the wax stamps and doing the research. And it's just like, I love all of that stuff. Either that, or I feel like I would be a Montessori teacher for like kids who are like between 2 and 4. Cause I think that's like the cutest age. They're so adorable. Yeah. But also it would be really exhausting. So I'd probably actually be really terrible at that.
Both phenomenal answers. Nicola, this has been such a joy to speak to you.
It's been so lovely.
Thank you so much for chatting. And these have been your Netflix 9.